So I saw this video I wanted to share with you guys. I don't know if it's gonna work, but I'm gonna give it a try here. Made me think of always think about this when I get to this part of the chapter. Oh, I always think about that when we get to this, when I get to this chapter. Oh, Phooey, I gotta stop sharing. Okay, thank you. So, like, that was my era. Every time I get to this chapter, that's what goes through my head. And I've tried singing it at different times, and it just is, I thought I'd let Salt and Pepper do it for us. Okay, thanks for bearing with me. All right, so one thing I do like, actually, I think is legit about even the way they do that song is if you listen closely to the words, you know, she says all the good things and the bad things. And I think that that supports or that just is a sort of what I've been saying all along. Like this is, it's a, this is one of the best things about being human is this experience that we can share with people. But this, but because we live in a social environment and we are imperfect, sometimes, unfortunately, this one beautiful thing has been used as a way to inflict great pain on us. And I think that's unfortunate. But anyway, okay. So this slide is really about some of the research. The first one of the major, I'm sure, I suspect there probably were researchers before before we got to Alfred Kinsey, but probably the first contemporary researcher, and what I mean by contemporary is not ancient researcher, would have been a fellow by the name of Alfred Kinsey. And unfortunately, I don't have his books here at the office. I should bring them for future reference. But he did, he was a professor at the University of Indiana. And the story goes, you can actually watch a movie about this one. It's called Kinsey. It's one of those docudramas. So it's based on a true story, but it's been fictionalized, you know, for entertainment purposes. And he was a entomologist. He was a bug researcher at the University of Indiana in the 1940s. And for whatever reason, I forget the specifics, he started teaching a class on human sexuality. And in order to get into the class, you had to be married. So students were lying about being married in order to take the class, right? Because this is a time when it's when you can't buy legal birth control for unmarried women. And he said he, the story goes is that he was being asked all of these questions by his students, and he didn't have really any data to back up what he was saying. So he got permission from his advisor, from his administration, to go out and actually interview thousands. So he did the first organized, systematic data collection on human sexual behavior. And the first book is produced, is published in 1948, and it's about that thick. It's really dry. It is just full of charts and just data. Like it's just a very dry book, surprisingly boring. And then, you know, about 5 years later, he published a secondary, another book, which is a little bit thinner. And critics have observed that women's sexuality appears to be more complicated. Why did he not have more data on men? Now, there's lots of arguments regarding the rigorousness of his research. The if you've ever heard the statistic, 10% that one in 10 people is has homosexual or is engaged in homosexual activity, that comes from his research. If I remember correctly, like it's what's really cool if you actually watch that documentary is they do get into some of his research methods and some of his interview techniques and how he trained his interviewers not to respond, you know, like not to like show facial expressions, to use certain words. And, you know, as a social science researcher, it's really interesting to observe like the structure, the replication, the validity, right? The validity and the reliability that he put into his research. So today there's the Institute of Sex Research, which is named after him in Indiana. Now, it's also an unfortunate tale because while he was producing all of this research and his classes were exceedingly popular, he quickly lost his job because it was he was saying, you know, like nearly half or over half of people were not virgins when they got married and they didn't regret it. And these ideas were very contradictory for his time. So that resulted, he was just saying things that people didn't like to hear. So he lost his job. Masters and Johnson may be somebody that you're more familiar with. And Masters and Johnson's research comes out of, I should know what decade, but they're the people there. It's a man and a wife. It's a man and a woman. I don't know if they're a husband and wife or not, but they were the first people to actually record orgasms and measure how the body responds. So they develop this idea, what's called the human sexual response. And if you've ever heard of the idea that that we go through these different stages in the sexual response from excitement, plateau, orgasm, and resolution. And this idea that comes from Masters and Johnson. So in their book, I don't know if I still have a copy of it, but I used to pass it out to my in-person classes. You can read about things like how blood pressure changes, how blood flow changes, all of the physical changes, all of the bodily changes at each one of the stages in the human sexual response. And so I used to tease students and say, once you know the signs of an orgasm, you could tell if somebody was faking it or not, right? How the nipples change and the cheeks change and the anus changes and all of these sort of the blood pressure and the breathing, your pain sensitivity, all of these things change as you move through these different stages. A couple important phrases for you to know right here, and that's the vasocongestion. Vasocongestion is a fancy word for inflammation or swelling. So when the penis is erect, that's because it's a vasocongestion, the blood flows. And it is true that the blood often flows away from the head to your other body parts and they get red and swollen and all of the blood comes to them and they're warm to the touch. And that's all part of the process. The variations, let me see if I can remember, it's been a minute since I taught this chapter, but what this is it's the stages, it's the sequence, how people go from excitement to plateau to orgasm to resolution. And there are three variations for women. So for men, there's basically only one. It's excitement, plateau, orgasm, and resolution, right? But for women, they can go excitement, they can have that one, excitement, plateau, orgasm, resolution. They can go excitement, plateau, and then resolution with no orgasm, or they can go excitement, plateau, orgasm, 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 resolution. So women are physiologically more complicated sexually than their counterparts, than their male counterparts. So here's some comment or observations about what motivates. So in some psychology textbooks, the chapter on sex is actually in the same chapter as it is with food. And so it's framed in the context of what motivates us to engage in sexual activity. And there's been a lot of research done on these bonobos, because they're genetically very similar to humans. And the bonobos have been studied because they're a very nonviolent group. They use caressing and sexual stimulation as a form of social bonding and to diffuse conflicts. They will interact with bonobos who are of the same gender of the same sex as them. So female bonobos will caress female bonobos and vice versa. And so they've been studied from the perspective of, is there a species that uses sex for more than procreation? And the research on the bonobos says yes, absolutely, that that sex is also for pleasure, right? A couple terms on here. I think I did talk about the evolution and the mate selection. So what evolutionary psychologists have pointed out or have observed is that the the things that men find sexually attractive and sexually arousing, and the things that women find sexually attractive and sexually arousing, are, one argument is it's grounded in evolutionary survival. So youth, right? Youth is more desirable than old, and youth after a certain age. So once a person has gotten, the whole goal from an evolutionary psychological perspective is to reproduce. So we will be sexually attracted to any signs of sexual vitality for the purpose of reproduction. So previously I was talking about, you know, the when she's closer to ovulation, right? If the goal is to get pregnant, if the goal is to conceive and reproduce, then naturally, biologically, she is going to be more interested in sexuality and sex when she is, she's going to be more horny when she's more fertile. It boils down to that. And he will find her more sexually appealing when she is more fertile. So all of the, like, the hippier, sorry, hip women who have bigger hips are biologically probably more able to have a child or to successfully deliver a child. So women with a little bit more on their hips, you know, the hourglass is more appealing. Larger breasts is more appealing because that assumes nourishment for the offspring. So these the things that we men and women find sexually attractive from this theoretical perspective is about evolutionary reproduction. Now, you fast forward to a culture where we fill our bodies with chemicals and birth control and various things, and survival is less about, or reproduction, survival is more about money, and the data begins to look a little bit different. Women seem to be more attractive. So maybe you've heard there's a really cool research project. Oh, I should see if I can make it available. Cool research project where women are asked to rank the attractiveness of a man based on their image alone, right? And she'll rate, you know, these guys based 1 to 10. Then they take the high numbers, the more attractive images, and they assign them a status, a wage, and they give them a low status. They take the less attractive men and they assign them a very high status, very large wage. Then they take these images out into the world and they have different women rate them on their attractiveness. Now, all of a sudden, the wealthy, unattractive man becomes more attractive, and the less attractive man who doesn't have a good job becomes more attractive. So what this suggests to researchers is that women and men are looking for different things. And the evidence, the data, the patterns suggest that women will sacrifice attractiveness for resources, in this case, money, and commitment. If he's not attractive, but he has money, okay. If he's not attractive and doesn't have money, but he's willing to make a commitment, then she may choose him, even if he doesn't have any money, if he's willing to make a commitment over a man who has money, who won't make a commitment. So if you ain't cute, maybe you have money. And if you don't have money, then if you'll stand by her. But men, it pretty much remains the same. He's always interested in attractiveness and vitality. So I'm going to stop right here and see you in a bit.